So, a good old-fashioned oil change video today. Nothing exciting. This is going to just be a basic guide to doing your own oil change on a Toyota Vitz, also known as a Toyota Yaris, once known as a Toyota Echo, and also known as a Daihatsu Charade in Europe. Now, you can call it what you like, but this one has the little 1.3-litre engine connected up to a CVT gearbox. But honestly, the oil change specifics will apply to a wide range of these cars and their engines. Now, sensible oil and filter service interval for these cars is about 10,000 kilometers. These things aren't black and white, so to some extent they depend on the type of use you give the car. If you do lots of short trips and cold starts around town, for example, then it may pay to do shorter intervals. Obviously, you will need the front of the car raised somehow so that you can get safely under the engine and crank on it with tools. So it needs to be either up on ramps or, like here, I'm using reliable axle stands, and I've left the jack in place on the one side as a safety measure. The other thing that's worth saying is it's helpful if the engine is warm, maybe not hot, but if it's not stone cold, then the old oil is going to flow out faster and more easily. Right, so under the car at the front is the oil filter. This one's white, but they can be any color, of course. And then at the rear of the oil sump is the oil drain plug, which you can see here. It's the 14mm hex head bolt. So I needed a metric 14mm socket for that, along with a bar, and also, obviously, an oil drain pan. And I'm wearing nitrile gloves, you could use latex gloves, because I haven't done an oil change yet where I didn't get my hands covered in oil. So if the oil is likely to be hot, then this is a safety thing as much as it is to do with cleanliness. The bolt needs to be undone counterclockwise, as you'd expect, and if you're looking at it from the front of the car, it pays not to let yourself get confused with the reverse angle. What's important here is to get the socket on the bolt head nice and square, and I tried to hold it there while cranking on it because of the awkward angles that are a consequence of working on the ground like this. It's easy to get things misaligned, and that's how you end up stripping a bolt head if it's on there tight, which, as you can see, this one was. This is kind of typical of mechanics, probably, who didn't want their job leaking on them, so they make damn sure. But it's kind of at the expense of whoever has to do it in the future, and over-tightening the bolts will eventually lead to wearing them out, and even worse, the internal threads of the oil sump. Anyway, with a bit of weight, this let go, and once it's loose, a typical bolt will just undo by finger. Make sure the oil pan is in the right place, and whip out the plug. Now, the oil will dribble out of the sump for some time. The longer you can leave it, the more you'll get. At least until it's only dripping slowly. And while I waited, I undid the oil filler cap, as this will help let air into the top of the engine, and I also had a look at the drain plug in good light. Gave it a clean with some brake clean. This one is in reusable shape, but the hex head is a touch mangled. That's from the over-tightening and letting the sockets get misaligned in the past. So I might replace this next time, but I don't like replacing them often, even though they're cheap, because the steel threads are very hard, whereas the aluminium of the sump is soft. And every time you put a new bolt in, you will cut in slightly different threads because of the variance from bolt to bolt. And eventually you'll end up weakening those female alloy threads to a undesirable degree. And of course, when you strip the sump plug itself, then you've really got a problem that's not easy to fix. And continuing with the best practice, when you do put the bolt back in, it really should be torqued accurately with a torque wrench, because this eliminates the guesswork that's hard to do under a car. The correct torque for this M12 bolt is, I believe, 28 foot-pound, which is 38 newton-meters. And when I put the bolt back in by finger, I made sure it went in nice and easily. It's easy to get threads crossed, so if it doesn't do up easily by finger, then something's wrong. Don't just put a tool on it and start cranking. Only once the bolt head is up against the sump did I put the torque wrench on it and tighten it up. Again, with the car on the ground, this can be awkward. With my half-inch torque wrench here, I could only get one click per turn out of the ratchet. And again, that socket wants to be held nice and square on the bolt. Lastly, I gave the area a little spray with brake clean. I want it clean in general, but it's also because when I check it for leaks, I need to know if it's new or old oil that I find. Next is the filter. It's reasonably accessible on this car. Sometimes they're really awkward to access, but this one's okay. Now, you should just be able to undo it by hand, or two hands, as in my case. That's if the old filter wasn't over-tightened again, and if it hasn't had years to get itself glued in place. If you can't do it by hand, then you do need a tool, like this filter wrench. It's just a strap which tightens as you turn it counterclockwise, which I had on hand, but I didn't actually need to use it. I'll put some links to tools like this below, but the good news is basically anything will work on this car here because there is plenty of space. Now, these filters always make a mess because they start spilling oil as they're undone. Nothing for it but to wear gloves and obviously have the drain pan directly underneath. Once it starts draining in a constant stream, I just stop undoing it and leave it till it finishes, and then take it off, and remember that the filter itself, because it's oriented upright like this, will be full of oil. So I tipped it up and emptied out the old oil inside before I binned it. Then I left the filter mount there to drip drain for a while, and also checked the attachment area. Because this came off easily, there was no reason to be concerned, but you should always just check the seal ring to make sure that there's no pieces of old rubber that have got stuck there. If there are, they will have to be cleaned off before the new filter can go back on. So, on to the new oil and filter. This is an Australian brand, full synthetic 5W30, which is what's recommended locally. These engines are not terribly sophisticated or sensitive to oil standards, so anything that meets the Toyota's specifications will suffice. This is a 4-litre bottle. This engine has a fill capacity of either 3.2 or 3.7 litres, depending on the specific model. Either way, it's less than 4. And this is the new oil filter, just bought from a local shop. The easiest way to get the right size is to just look up the specific car on their systems. But of course, you'd want to compare it to the old one just to make sure it is in fact the same. As preparation, it's a good idea to just dip your finger in the new oil and put a light smearing around the new filter's seal, as this is going to help it go on, but it'll also make it easier to take off next time. And secondly, since this filter goes on the engine upright, I could pre-fill it with oil. This is best practice because the engine is fed its oil through the filter first, which means that if you put a dry filter on, when you first run the engine, it won't be getting any oil until after the oil pump has had enough time to fill up the filter from the sump feed. So if you do this, you short-circuit that moment of no oil. You will have to be careful not to spill it, of course. On a lot of engines, the filters get mounted on sideways or even upside down, and you can't do this, so it's just a sort of nicety when you can. So I gave the engine mount a bit of a clean with a rag, soaked in a little brake clean just to make sure the metal was nice and clear of everything, and then screwed on the new filter. Again, be very careful not to cross any threads, and when you get it up against the body, just tighten it by hand. There are torque specs if you have a socket tool for a torque wrench, but it's sufficient to just turn it about half a turn or so against the seal. Very easy to over-tighten if you used something like that strap wrench in reverse without any way of controlling it. And lastly, the new oil that goes in, of course. So as I said before, if you know the oil capacity of the engine, you can just dump that much in, maybe less a bit to account for old oil that didn't drain out. So this being a 4-litre container and knowing that I want to put in a bit over 3, I can see that on the container's gauge. This isn't exact, of course, but the problem is you can't really use the oil dipstick because the car is up on an inclined angle, and also the oil you pour in takes some time to drain through the engine and down into the sump, so you can only really use the dipstick later. It's best to therefore keep track of how much you put in from the start. Once the oil is in, I ran the engine for a while. I want it to develop some oil pressure and get the temperature up, and then I'm going to check it for leaks while it's still lifted. In the meantime, I poured the old oil into an old container for disposal. You want to take this to a proper facility. Usually the auto shops will take them, or they have bins outside for just that purpose if you're lucky. And then I had a look under the car just to check for any obvious leaks if the seals aren't holding. Oil will drain down to the low points here if it is leaking, so it should be fairly obvious, and this all looked good. Okay, then you're good to go. Once you've let the car sit flat for a while, say overnight, then you can check the oil dipstick to get an accurate reading to see if you need to top it up any more to its maximum, maybe. Otherwise, that's it. I hope that was helpful. Have fun.